Good morning, everyone. It's great to see so many people here. This is an amazing turnout. Really excited to have people here, and the resource sharing user group is such an important time to meet colleagues, because with interlibrary loan, there's a trust relationship between libraries where often you don't even know who is at the library, who the patron is that is asking to borrow an item from your collection. But because of the trust between libraries and between librarians and the staff that manage our interlibrary loan departments and take care of the material that we send between libraries, that's how we're able to have such a successful program of sharing and providing resources for users beyond our collection, what we own in-house. And so I just want to thank you all for the work that you do, and you know, taking care of materials, communicating with each other, and I hope you'll take this opportunity to just get to know some people in the room that maybe you haven't met before, because as you get to know people, it can help you later on when maybe you say, hey, I met someone from that library. Let me give them a call or let me send them an email and say, you know, we really need this resource for this special case. You know, can you help me out? I continually hear great stories about how the personal connections help our libraries make those resource sharing connections as well. So thank you all for being here. The program today, we don't have an agenda slide. I didn't think to put that in. So just so you know, we're going to do a few announcements of some awards, and then we have two speakers, or actually three, that we're going to have some short presentations from the community on activities different libraries are doing. And then I'm going to give a short presentation about some OCLC initiatives that we're working on. And then the rest of the time, I believe, unless I'm forgetting something in the last slides that we'll come to, but I believe the rest of the time is just going to be more discussion like you've been having already over coffee and breakfast. So thank you. And with that, then, we're going to do some STARS announcements, RUSA STARS. And so I'd like to invite up to help with this announcement, Edibola Fabico, sorry. And I think Stephanie Spires. Edibola is from North Carolina State University and is a member of RUSA STARS and is gonna make the announcement for the Virginia Boucher Distinguished Interlibrary Loan Librarian Award. And Stephanie's going to help with the mentoring award, I believe. So, yes, thank you.
Hi, everyone. I am delighted to be here today to present the STARS Virginia Boucher Distinguished ILL Librarian Award, sponsored by OCLC, to Jaleesa Horton, the Director of Access and Resource Sharing Services at Southern Methodist University. That is a mouthful. This prestigious award recognizes an individual who has made significant contributions to the interlibrary loan and document delivery services field. Jaleesa Horton embodies the spirit of the value of Virginia Boucher, who was a pioneer and champion of interlibrary loan and document delivery. She has made a lasting impact on the profession and the community of the users she serves. She is definitely a role model and inspiration for all of us who work in this area. So Jaleesa unfortunately could not be here, so, but yes, please.
Round of applause.
Thank you, Adibola. I'm Stephanie from Atlas Systems, and we are pleased to be able to sponsor the RUSA STARS Mentoring Award. And the recipient of this award is selected by the RUSA STARS committee to honor and support a person, a library practitioner new to interlibrary loan, document delivery, or electronic reserves.
So STARS is very pleased to announce that Takumbo Adeshine from the Access Services Librarian at Bronx Community College of the City University of New York, so CUNY, is the award recipient this year.
And Takumbo will receive a $1,250 award to be able to support expenses for ALA and a STARS mentor to help navigate. So congratulations, Takumbo.
Happy to be together with you all today. And we have a theme for this session, which is about collaboration. So I started off by talking about how our libraries in resource sharing connect with each other a lot of times when we don't even really know who's on the other end. We just see this library name or an OCLC symbol, and sometimes we know the symbol but don't even know the name. We've just gone to that library so many times, put them in a lender string, and we don't really know who's on the other side. Sometimes, like I said, we may not even know the library's name. We just know that three or five letter symbol. But also, a lot of our libraries have collaborations, have networks, have consortia, state groups that we work very closely together. And when we come together as libraries in a tight collaboration, we can actually achieve certain advantages because we're sharing work. And we have on this screen one of the reports that OCLC Research did about collaboration as a strategic choice. And the report really isn't specifically about resource sharing, but it's really about how do libraries come together? What are the efficiencies of working together? Also, what are the challenges? Sometimes working together creates its own challenges. A lot of time can be spent thinking about and working together on how to normalize policies or decide on even things like loan periods or renewals or some things that seem so petty. And we may hear a little touch on that in our second community presentation today. But first, for collaboration, I'm happy to introduce Helen Pinder. And Helen is from the SWAN Library Services, and she works for SWAN as a consultant on resource sharing. So I'd like to ask Helen to come up, and she is going to talk a little bit about the work that she's done within the SWAN Library Services group of libraries. I think Helen said maybe there are around 100 libraries that she works with, and I'm excited to hear more about what they've been doing. Thank you, Helen.
Thank you, Peter. Good morning, everybody. My name is Helen Pinder. I am the resource sharing consultant for SWAN. As Peter mentioned, we are a library consortium of 100 libraries. We're about to be 101. We started out in 1974 with 9 public libraries. We've grown a little. Today we were 100, almost 101, and now we are multi-type. So still mostly public, but also 2 academic, 2 special, and 1 school, all sharing Circe Dynex's Symphony Workflows ILS. So we have 1.5 million titles, 8.3 million items, million users. And you can see our service area encapsulates 1.9 million people. So we've got 1 million users, but the service area is 1.9 million people. Our ILL last year was 1 million ILLs, and 630,000 of that was reciprocal borrowing. Because we are all on the same ILS, the vast majority of our interlibrary loan is SWAN library to SWAN library. So we achieve that through van delivery, and then patrons roam. I mean, you can't really wander too very far in that service area without visiting a SWAN library. So SWAN membership includes all of those library services, all those platforms. I'm not going to read them off. But basically, if you're a SWAN member, you have access to all of that. It's part of your membership fee. So if you're an Illinois library and you're not part of SWAN, come see me. And then we also provide services, centralized notification. And again, that's because we're all checking out in the same system, so all the notices go out centrally, and it just simplifies things for the library, simplifies things for the patrons. There's consistency across the libraries, and that's what we're aiming to do. And obviously, there's a cost savings with all of us pooling our resources like this. And then centralized billing is for lost and damaged material. I do that as well. Centralized cataloging, centralized e-commerce, centralized OCLC configurations, and that's kind of important because, again, consistency, and also because we want to make sure that those 100 libraries aren't using OCLC to interlibrary loan things between SWAN to SWAN libraries. We want that going through the catalog. So there's deflections, there's all sorts of configuration that has to be consistent for the services to work effectively for our members. And then obviously training and support, there's a lot of that. So going back to the OCLC configuration, something we're really, really excited about is in 2021, we started tinkering with real-time availability in WorldCat Discovery. And what we were able to do is automate a no response for a request that we received if it had a status, an OPAC status, that is universally recognized as unavailable. If you were building your lender string manually and you were checking the catalogs before adding lenders to the string, and you saw checked out, on order, on hold, in transit, or missing, you wouldn't add that lender to the string. So we took those five statuses and we added them to the status tables for all 100 libraries, and it took me 4 days to do it. But what it meant was that if any of our libraries received a request and the actual location at that moment that the request arrived was one of those statuses, it wouldn't even appear in the Can You Supply queue. It would slide straight to the next lender. So that's staff time that our library staff don't have to check the queue, check the catalog. They don't even see it. And it's also borrower time saved because it's not going to sit in a queue for any amount of time. It's just going to go straight to the next lender in the string. You can achieve a lot with deflection policies, but this is so much more granular. And what really appealed to me about it was the ability to deflect on new material, because with 100 libraries, everybody has a different definition of new. And some libraries, you know, is it new to you? Is it new to the world? Do you restrict your new collection? Do you not? So this allowed each library to go in and, based on their own policies, not WorldCat policies, and decide whether or not they wanted to accept those requests to their queue or if they wanted to just bounce them. So I've got on the screen here, Woodridge has gone above and beyond reviewing their status lists of their collection, and they've populated availability depending on what they would send out. So you can see if you're trying to get a mystery from them, that's going to show as available. If you request something that's in mystery, that's their OPAC status for those items, it's going to land in their Can You Supply queue, and you're going to get human eyes on that. But if it's new adult or new juve, they're not going to see it. It's just going to go to the next lender in the string. I love this graph so much, you guys. I include the 2019 data just so you could see that COVID-19 crater that I'm sure we've all seen in our graphs. So that's kind of when we started like exploring real-time availability, and then we piloted it in 2021. So you can see between 2020 and 2021, we got just shy of 3,000 items that are being shunted automatically. So 3,000 items that humans didn't have to interact with and your borrowers didn't need to wait for. And then it just starts to climb fantastically. So in 2022 is when I populated all five of those statuses, the checked out, the on order, on hold, in transit, and missing. So all 100 of our libraries by the end of 22 had those statuses populated. And you can see it went from 2,900 system responded to 2,300 staff responded just in that 1 year. And then this year, you can see we're already on track to edge out 22, because I won't stop talking about this to my members. And every interaction is like, what are your statuses? Have you checked your status table? Why aren't you checking your status table now? So we're very, very excited about this. I'm hoping that it keeps ticking upwards and we get back to those pre-pandemic, lending. But we'll see. We'll see what the future holds for us. And I think that's it. Oh, it's not. One more slide. I forgot. So staff time is fantastically difficult to quantify, because I can check a catalog for one of my items in, 15 seconds, 30 seconds, 45 seconds. But if I'm at a library where I'm the ILO person and I'm also the CERC person and I'm part-time ref, depending on the size of your library, how many dedicated staff you have, your staff time is going to, you can't calculate it the same way as you could an academic or a public or a special or a school. So I tried to break it down as far as who's monitoring your queue and how many hours in a day it's being monitored. So if you have an ILL department, you've got eyes on that queue as long as you're open, I'm guessing, regular business hours. But with real-time availability, it never sleeps. So 24/7 monitoring for your supplier queue. And then with the item status lookup, again, I can check a catalog pretty quickly. Might take a little bit longer for other people. But with the system, it's seconds. It's actually fractions of seconds. I was looking at the reasons for no reports, and it's fractions of a second, but that it didn't fit neatly in the cell, and it sounded hyperbolic. But it is fractions of a second. And then the last bit is your max wait time if it is unavailable. So I was imagining a scenario where I am an ILL person in a library, and I get sick, or I take a little mini vacation, and I forget to go non-supplier. So requests are coming in my queue, and nobody's responding to them, and they're aging out, they're dropping out at 2 days or 4 days or whatever you're set for those to move on to the next lender. So the maximum amount of time, if you're reliant on staff to say no to everything, it's going to be a few days. But for the system, because it's constantly checking, the maximum amount that a patron would wait to get that no and then move to the next lender would be seconds. So a faster no. So less time for your borrower to have to wait. And less work for me when I come back from my vacation or my sickness or whatever it is. So, pretty clear benefit, at least for my consortium. I know everybody's different, but I can't say enough nice things about it. So if you want to find me when it gets to the roundtable time, I'm sitting back in the corner because I'm a resource sharing person and I like to hide in the corner. And I think that's all I've got for you today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Helen. And I do love this, just the difference in the amount of time than having to touch all these requests all the time. So if your library has not set up real-time availability, you know, Helen mentioned spending a few days. She has 100 libraries for setting it up for your library. It really is not not an onerous process. And so, yeah, talk to Helen about her experience, talk to us. There's a few other OCLC folks in the room, or reach out to me after, but we would love to get more libraries set up. We have, I don't know, around 1,500 libraries right now using this real-time availability. So if something is checked out, or even in a non-circulating location, it can just bounce on. As Helen said, and if you're curious, when you look at your statistics, this shows up in a stat labeled in your reasons for no report, so things that your library said no to for lending, there's a status column called system checked availability. So the system doing the work to check the availability. You could see if you have entries in there just to double check how that's working. Compared to the in use on loan is when a staff person has to look something up and says, nope, it's in use, it's on loan. And so if you compare those stats, that's really what we're seeing in this graph between the yellow and the black is the difference between system checked availability and in use on loan. All right, next I would like to introduce Emily Campbell and Kurt Munson. They're going to come up and talk a little bit about the Big Ten Academic Alliance.
So my name is Emily Campbell. I'm the Director of Document Delivery at the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor, and I'm very active within the BTAA, which is the Big Ten Academic Alliance, and which is, let's see, I have a slide. So these are the research libraries of the Big Ten Academic Alliance. There are 15 of us. There are going to be 17 this fall when USC and UCLA join us. So we're all big schools. We're all big research libraries, and we have been collaborating for about 60 years, starting as the community, whatever, cooperative community, I don't know, something, CIC.
For institutional cooperation.
Thank you. So I came into this work and I just really enjoy working with my fellow BTAA folks. This is exciting for me, and the University of Michigan is very reliant on the Big Ten because we don't have a strong state consortium for sharing, and so we are heavy users of the UBARL platform. So one of the things we're currently doing in the Big Ten is partnering with OCLC for their new product resource sharing for groups and in the development of that as a replacement for our UBARL platform. So we've been working with them, and just to step back a little bit, we also have this new structure where we're trying to pilot things at the Big Ten level. And I'm on the steering committee for that, and I have a couple of projects working through that. And one of them is our resource policy harmonization and access harmonization team. And luckily, I have a report due on Tuesday, so I was able to make a bit of a slideshow based on that. And one of the things we're trying to do is align our policies in order to give our patrons the same access and experience whatever school they're at. So out of 15 schools, we have a unified patron experience. We realize that each school is unique. We have our own things, but there are some basic things that we can work from. So to start with this, so this is the idea, right? Any format to any patron to any library, if availability, staffing, physical condition, electronic license, copyright, and technology will allow, right? Like, so that's our aspiration, okay? And like, it periodically everybody's like, oh, that's our first mile marker. I'm like, that's it. Like, there's not, like, we have to do so much to get to there. So that's our kind of, I call it our North Star. So for the resource access policy harmonization team, which is just made up of a bunch of librarians from around the consortia, I have the list at the end to say thank you because I cribbed most of this from our report. We started with our resource sharing agreement, right? We hadn't updated that since, 2011 maybe? That sounds right. That is one of the things, and we've been writing it with an aspirational tone so that it doesn't, we have that line about the exceptions, technology, copyright, et cetera, but we do not codify the exceptions within the document, right? We really try to make it a positive, forward-thinking document. And we also, we know, when we were presenting this to the ILO coordinators group, some people are like, wow, we just don't have the staffing right now. We're like, and we're so fine. We want to get things to each other, articles in particular, within 24 hours. There are limits on the physical material just because of UPS shipping zones. So we understand that there are limitations, and each library can adjust things in OCLC. You can put yourself your days to respond, whatever. So we're just trying to acknowledge that we have limits, but that our goal is to be as robust and quick as possible. So our highest priority is updating that. We have a draft that's going to our steering committee and then the deans and directors this summer. So we're pretty excited about that. And when we finished, I'll share that, but I can't yet. Actualizing this agreement will require change throughout our 15-plus libraries, right? So it's going to have to change a little bit, and this is the slow part, right? Thinking about how we change the way we collect, store, license, and move all of our collection formats. Let's face it, it's really difficult to share certain formats, et cetera. Some of our license negotiators in the Big Ten are much more aggressive at certain schools, and some are very passive. So we're trying to, really kind of get people to think about this. And we're going to need active and continued support from the deans and directors who don't usually care about resource sharing that much. And so they do care, but they're like, they don't know what our loan terms are, right? They don't know. They don't want it. That's not what they're thinking about. So we are, I've been working with them to try to get the idea. You have to set the tone. You have to tell us that this is what we need to do. And I know that most librarians don't really love to be told what to do. So like I said, this agreement aligns the experience across the consortium, but it's going to require all of us to look at our current loan terms for our local patrons, because right now we offer a 17-week loan term through the Big Ten, but not everybody gives a 17-week loan term to their local patrons. So we're asking people to have a look at that. We're also guaranteeing one renewal of 17 full weeks, which is not consistent. In fact, at Michigan, we're only offering 8 weeks currently, but we're going to change. So we're doing that, and we wanted to do unlimited renewals. And one of our biggest barriers was OCLC and how difficult it is to do multiple renewals. So that's my big plug right here in front of all of you. So that was really, really a barrier. From every school complains about that. We have some crazy workaround at Michigan. So, also people are like, how will we get the material back if it's out forever? There are things do come back. So we just keep saying that. Like I said, 17-week loan term plus a 17-week renewal. So really quick, this is a visualization that one of my colleagues, Melissa Amy Brown, put together. And we agree to share all of the things at the top, right, with our caveat. But what we really want to be able to share is we want to be able to share streaming media, data sets, ebooks through a standardized sharing mechanism. We want to be other, because who knows, right? What's coming next? So we're hoping to be able to do that. But if you look at data sets, I know at Michigan we have storage capability problems with data sets. So how do you share something you have trouble storing at your own home institution? Thinking about that. And, even the physical collections, we have special collections. We have an agreement about special collections. It's still very difficult to share special collections across the consortium. I love our special collections people, but they're very, it's hard. It's a lot of work. It takes time. And that's where staffing really comes in, I think. So all of those things, we really whole ebooks. Some of us are able to share whole ebooks depending on the licensing, but it's still a pain in the butt. And so that's our goal. Then one of the next things that's coming out of this in our report, we recommend about 8 other working groups. And one of them is on ebooks and ebook lending across the consortium. Another one is on digital lending, which would be controlled digital lending, but I'm not allowed to say that at Michigan. So So we have a bunch of working groups spawning from this. So we really like to work on this stuff. But it's really fun to work together in a consortium. I really enjoy that. I think that resource sharing at your own institution can be a little lonely because, like, you're the one, you know. So this is, I really appreciate all this. So I just want to acknowledge my team. Oh, one last thing. Sorry. So we put in our resource sharing agreement that we have an unflinching commitment to DEI. And I was like, well, what does that mean? Because, like, I feel like we say this a lot, like, but we're not, like, acting on it. So we really thought about it. And we feel strongly that by reducing barriers to our access for course and research materials, we're, you know, aligning with our commitment. We eliminate confusion with different, like, if we all have similar policies, we make it easier, right? We lessen the cost borne by students and researchers. You know, if we can get it for them easily, they're not paying for it. We can reduce the need for in-person travel to access materials. We cannot eliminate the need for in-person travel, right? Like, that is never going to happen, but we can reduce the need. We can enable the resources that are held by one library to be used throughout the library, or throughout the BTAA, which raises the usability and visibility of our materials by and about marginalized and underrepresented groups, right? Like, one of the things that came out of the initial report that our deans and directors, I guess, asked Lorcan Dempsey and Constant Malsuf and Mark Sandler to do, which was operationalizing the big collection, is that our collections are very different, actually, even though you think that we would be very similar. I don't want to use the word unique because that's a pretty loaded word, but, like, we have different things, and we want to be able to share them easily and create a culture where those things are available. I mean, for example, like, we have a huge manga collection. We want to be able to share that, you know, without... So all that stuff. So this is, like, what I think is acting on our commitment to DEI. I also believe that we have to, as a consortium, and this is phase two of my thinking, we have to be more active in sharing outside of our consortium. We are very good at lending, but, you know, for me, University of Michigan is a public university. We have a commitment to the public good. And how do we leverage our huge collection and help, you know, work with other schools that are outside of the Big Ten who aren't maybe as privileged as we are? So those are the things we're thinking about there. And then this is my team. I've got people from Rutgers, and I just want to acknowledge, you know, everybody, Brian Miller from The Ohio State, and Bryn, and all these folks, and the support staff at Big Ten. I just wanted to say, I just didn't want to have the slides up there because a lot of this work was they helped with. So that's what I'd be happy to talk later to anybody if you have questions. Thank you.
I have no question.
Go Blue!
Good morning, everybody. I'm Kurt Munson, head of Access Services at Northwestern University. A number of years ago, I gave a presentation and said, I don't have slides, I just like to talk. And that's kind of what I'm going to do today. And my reason for doing this is because this big collection and our work with OCLC for, you know, resource sharing for groups is rapidly moving, so trying to put stuff on slides doesn't really seem to necessarily make a whole lot of sense. The other thing that I'm also going to do today is building on what we've heard from other people. There's a type of coffee that you get in the Netherlands, and it's called café verkeerd, and it means coffee done wrong. So what I'm going to do is start with the notion of who ultimately is going to be using this stuff. And what do we need to have in place for that undergraduate or graduate student or faculty member or whatever else to be able to use that thing? Because ultimately, and library deans get very irritated when I say this, but I don't care. Libraries without patrons are warehouses. It's the point when somebody needs something. How do we ensure that they can get that thing that they need? Well, we have to have a delivery system. Now, we're really good at delivery systems in the Big Ten because we've been doing this for 60 years and so on and so forth, and OCLC has been, you know, wonderful helping with this. And, you know, I was part of the SWAN network at the Brookfield Public Library, so, you know, we can do that part of it. Can we do it better? Sure. Can we do it for more stuff than just returnables? Sure. Just have to figure out how to do that. But if you take that a step back, if the patron can't find the things, or we, with our collective probably 1,000 years of knowledge of interlibrary loan processes and so on and so forth, and, you know, metadata and so forth, you know, can't find the thing for our patron, we're never going to get that delivery portion of it done. So we have to have a mechanism for discovery. And I would argue very strongly, as we did in multiple white papers that we wrote in the Big Ten, that that discovery should probably be in the same discovery layer that they're using for local collections. You know, we talk about this notion of the hidden curriculum in higher education, of all of these things you like need to learn to navigate just being in college. I mean, I went to a high school that had 600 students in it in rural Illinois. Trust me, going to college was this massive change where I'm like, I don't know what I'm doing. And one of my favorite stories is a friend of mine's friend from high school went to UMass Amherst, which has this ridiculously tall library. Now, why they decided to do that, I don't know. But that's what they did. But she was petrified of the building, which kind of makes sense. So we have to make that discovery system easy for our patrons. They have way more important things to do than learn multiple library systems. But that discovery needs to be one place. APIs, hint, hint, nudge, nudge, that we can put together in one place. But that also then means that we need to be able to build a corpus of information of inventory. And determine, you know, the availability of that. So we've got really good stuff with OCLC in terms of, you know, X, Y, and Z. Yeah. Record harmonization, nudge, nudge. but if we look at this in the totality of what the patrons might want or need, how do we get our special collections in there? How do we get those finding aids in there? How do we get all of those data sets that our universities are collecting in there? What are we going to do with all of this open access stuff that, you know, NIH and NEH and so on and so forth are requiring? How do we build out this entire collection as opposed to having it siloed? Now, I don't necessarily have an answer to that question. I have many opinions on many things. But as we look at building the big collection in the Big Ten, I don't want us to necessarily be, you're all in Chicago. as Daniel Burnham said, make no small plans, for they shall not stir the hearts of man. And I think we need to look at this very holistically as we move into what's frankly becoming a much more complicated environment for us to be in. You know, it was simple when we just had books and print journals, because you put them in Arial and you sent them off, or you physically sent the book off. But, you know, now we've got all of these other things that we're working with, and how do we incorporate these things? How do we build that big collection so that we can therefore make it discoverable to the patrons, so that then all of us that do, you know, document delivery and interlibrary loan can, you know, deliver it? Also, how do we as a consortia or all of the partners that we are here create a mechanism so that somebody can see and view that article that, I see Hillary over there, so I'm gonna pick on Marilyn. If they've got something and a patron at Northwestern wants it, why are we having to send a PDF of it? Can't we create some sort of mechanism to give the Northwestern patron access to that single article? But our university systems, once you sign into them, you've got keys to the kingdom. So, you know, how do we create the mechanism for that sort of thing? And again, I don't have the answer to this, but yeah. So, I mean, I think we've got a lot of possibilities. I think we've got a lot of stuff that we're doing in the Big Ten, which is super helpful. But I also want to make sure that what we're doing in cooperation with OCLC, that we make sure that what everybody is doing in their situation, you know, whether that's Ivy's Plus or whatever, you know, the state of California is doing, or a variety of other places, that we can bring all of that together so that we're not all reinventing the wheel. So, okay, I'll get off my soapbox.
Thank you, Kurt. I think that's seeded maybe some of the discussion we hope to have. And like I said before, discussion isn't limited to topics on the table. So yeah, we look forward to that part as well. I just have a few words to follow up a little bit on this theme of consortia and libraries working together and the potential that's there. But before I do start this, I just wanted to say, who has all their policies up to date, that you've got them fresh and ready to go? Okay, well, you know, I think Emily may be inspired and the work of the Big Ten to us to think about how we go back and look at policies and the power that that can have just to organize us for the future. But what I wanted to talk about regarding consortia, libraries working together, one of the things that we're doing at OCLC is OCLC has provided consortial borrowing systems for libraries to use. Some of you may have heard of the D2D system. VDX is also a consortial borrowing system that OCLC has used over the years. And What we started to realize, and it was one of the experiences I really had in my years working in the library, was how that work together as a cooperative of libraries tended to be done in a separate system. And then when I wanted to go out to other libraries I had relationships with, cooperated with, I had to move between platforms. I had to move requests between platforms. I had to try to communicate to library users that, oh, try this system. Oh, you didn't find it there? Try this system over here. Oh, well, all right, submit it through interlibrary loan. And the user's just like, interlibrary loan, this branded system, that. And so what we have done, and we've announced, just launched just recently, is a platform to bring all of this sharing together in a single centralized location. And that's what we're working with the Big Ten on implementing there. We have some other state groups that are going to be implementing this, and we're talking to other groups of libraries about how we bring that experience for library users so everything is in one place. A user can start in discovery as well as access within the library and then expand to that group where they may have extended privileges like 17-week loan periods and potentially, hopefully we'll get there, Emily, seamless renewals. So that's something we'll work on. But the platform doesn't require staff in the back office to be moving requests around between this system, that system, but it scales out to the world on the WorldShare ILL network. And so this is really the vision behind resource sharing for groups. And we're able to drive that consortial borrowing through intelligence where we profile, even we heard about real-time availability and some ability to configure collections on what circulates. But for consortia, there are a lot of policies that go into what you can circulate, what you can't circulate across the consortia. Material types, all sorts of basically profiles, circulation profiles. We're able to take circulation profiles within the consortia and use that to optimize the sharing and delivery of resources to library users. So we're really excited about this because it powers the request within the network of libraries, the consortia of libraries, and then out onto the broader network to the whole 10,000 plus libraries that work, that use OCLC WorldShare. But not just OCLC WorldShare, in that another thing that was really interesting from Helen's presentation was talking about all the different systems their library systems use, all the different platforms going on in the background. We want resource sharing to be fully integrated with the ILS, with the Discovery Service, with any other ILL service or fulfillment network that you're using. And we're able to do this through standards. And if you were at the resource sharing, one of the resource sharing virtual web series that we had a series of six web series this spring, starting in March and went through June, but we had a whole session on how we're starting to use standards more to create these integrations with other systems. And so NSIP for circulation integration, so that things you borrow circulate through the catalog, through the ILS to make it easier for users. ISO is the way we connect with other ILL systems or sometimes with even an ILS system. If the request comes in there, it can push into WorldShare. So we're building this platform to be built on standards so that libraries can integrate it into whatever service they're using. So I'm really excited about resource sharing for groups. I hope if you have libraries that you work with and want to think how you can optimize your collaboration, that you'll come talk to me. We're also starting to put more material up on the website and also talk to the BTAA about the work that we're doing with them. But before we wrap up and just let you go back to discussion, I just wanted to point out some ways to get involved, some ways to get more information. So OCLC and Atlas have booths in the exhibit hall. They're right beside each other, so come stop by and talk to all of us. And then the table discussions, of course. And I'll just say regarding the table discussions, there's nothing coming into this room immediately after, so don't feel pressured to get up and go, you know, leave when you need to, but we do have this room for a while. And then the ILL community. It says start discussions in the OCLC Community Center. If you subscribe to WorldShare ILL, you all have access to the Community Center and the resource sharing part of that. We're actually updating the Community Center this year, so look for some updates that we hope actually enhance the ability to communicate and network with your colleagues. We will also be posting the slides from the session today in the Community Center, so you'll be able to see anything that we talked about today. So I mentioned the web series OCLC RSC 24 that will likely launch in March, but we also that series features presentations like we heard today, presentations from you. So if you're doing something at your library, anything you'd like to share with the community, we're always looking for new people to participate or just attend. And then the listservs, despite sophistication, we still do a lot by email, I think, at our libraries. So we do have a lot of robust discussion going on the listservs. And more ways to get involved here. We're always trying to find out what your interests are. So I do know now I really got to buckle down on renewals, find out what the deal is. But also, you know, anything, anything you want to mention, that ways that we can improve the service, we're looking to find out from those of you that are hands on keyboards every day, so we can really understand how the impact of new development. And I know Atlas Systems is also similarly with Iliad looking for ways to foster discussions. They also have a new users group that to help people starting out with Iliad to be able to understand all the functionality available to them. And we do a product insight session about every couple months on new things coming out from OCLC. So the next one is July 25th. A lot of stuff going on. A lot of this is on the website and all, but I just wanted, while you're here and thinking about it, to plant the seed on that. But instead of Q&A, we're all here in the room. And so if you have questions, you heard something interesting, seek that person out in the room. And then I just encourage you, like I started, to meet people, get a business card, take a name, take a photo of their badge, walk away with some information, some connections that will help you in your work going forward. So thank you again, everybody, for coming. Thank you to our speakers and our award winners. Give them one last round of applause. All right, thank you everyone. And you know, there are the topics on the table. I also have a slide here with some topics that I think these are all represented on the tables, but just as ideas of things you may want to discuss and learn more about. Thank you so much.